Hello friends, welcome to AKS. Today we are dealing with a topic called genetically modified crops. This is a part of the science and technology series we have started. In that, biotechnology. In that, we have dealing applications of biotechnology in medicine, agriculture, food processing, and environment. In medicine, we have already dealt stem cells, draft guidelines on stem cells, gene editing, three parent baby, etc. You can watch this in the playlist. Now we are dealing with agriculture. Applications of biotechnology in agriculture. In that part, we are seeing genetically modified crops. If you need further understanding of this topic, you can also see science and technology videos. That is approach to science and technology. There is a video you can watch. And then you have two videos on how to approach biotechnology for UPSC. What are the disciplines involved in biotech? Branches, uses, benefits, threats, and way forward of biotechnology. You can watch this for better understanding. So let us start with GM crops. Let us understand genetically modified crops in a very simple way. See, for example, I want early ripening of tomatoes. So I insert some gene to early ripen the tomatoes. Insertion of this gene into the fruit or tree or plant is called genetically modified crops. We will understand in detail in the next coming slides. Genetically modified organisms are those organisms in which the genetic material has been altered in a way that it does not occur naturally by mating or natural recombination. See, naturally there are two processes, either through mating or natural recombination. But in these both ways, the desired result is not coming. So we are trying to insert a gene for better results. Let us understand with an example. Let us take the example of cotton. Cotton is generally infected by a lot of pests. One of the most significant is pink boll worm. This affects the crop in no time. So it was necessary to invent something to disturb these pink boll worms and get the cotton produced. So BT cotton was introduced. What is BT cotton? See, Bacillus thuringiensis. This is the scientific name of BT cotton. See, this is a bacterium. This is introduced into the cotton so that it becomes pest resistant. That is, the pests cannot enter into the cotton crop and destroy them. So this is one of the advantages of genetically modified crops. Now let us see, what is a genetically modified crop? A crop which has a gene artificially inserted into it from another species, even unrelated to it. It gives some desired properties. Genetically modified crops are mostly either pest resistant or herbicide tolerant. We have discussed. See, in this they have said another species. See, we are using plant, that is for example cotton, but we are using bacterium called Bacillus thuringiensis. In the same way, it need not be from the same plant or same crop, it could be from different species altogether. So are there other GM crops in India? No. Apart from BT cotton, many trials were tried, not allowed. The government has not approved the commercial cultivation of other GM crops, though efforts have been made for brinjal and mustard. See, here there is a problem. We really do not know the repercussions of genetically modified crops. Cotton is not an edible thing, we will not eat cotton, so the problem is minute. But if you go to something like brinjal or tomato or some other products, the consumption may lead to different diseases maybe later. Sometimes it can be passed on to the next generation. So we really do not know whether we are successful or not. So government is reluctant in introducing other crops like brinjal, etc. So if you see the history, the first GM crop for commercialization was BT cotton. Bollgrad 1, you don't have to remember this, but just for understanding, provided immunity against the boll worm, and this was developed by Monsanto. Monsanto was a company. It released Bollgrad 2 in 2006. So India has become the world's largest producer of cotton, partly due to BT cotton, which accounts for 90% of total cotton acreage in the country. Acreage is the space, that is land. India commercialized only genetically engineered crop, that is BT cotton, with Cry1AC gene. This is the subgene of the BT cotton. BT cotton greatly contributed to significant income in the farm income. And if you see, the BT cotton seeds are rising in India, and the acreage, that is the land, is also increasing where BT cotton is growing. Genetically modified crops and products are stringently regulated for efficacy, biosafety, environment safety, and socio-economic conditions through mandatory regulations and procedures. So this is the regulatory framework in India regarding genetically modified crops. Government of India, this is Department of Biotechnology, in this RDAC, that stands for Recombinant DNA Appraisal Committee. This is the policy recommendation body. And you have RCGM, Regulatory Committee on Genetic Modifications. This is on manual of guidelines, monitoring safety, procedure for restricting crops, etc. The other wing is Ministry of Environment. Next is GEAC. There was a direct question in 2018 or 17 regarding GEAC, Genetically Engineering Approval Committee. What is it and what is the prominence of it was the question. So know about it. See, approval of genetically modified organisms activities, permission or large scale experiments, permission will be given by GEAC only. Here RCGM, we have seen Institutional Biosafety Committee is there in it, which implements guidelines. Every state will have its own biosafety committees for regulations of violations relating to GMO. And then you will have district level biosafety committees. This is the flowchart of regulatory framework of India and GM crops. Let us see the benefits of genetically modified crops. First is food security. See, it can feed a rapidly increasing population because it shows dramatically increased yields. We are able to produce in small area a lot of crop. The increase of the yield will increase and the crop productivity also will increase. So, in terms of food security, as our population is also growing, it could be a potential benefit to us. The next is reduction in imports. See, it is very important for us to be indigenous. That is, we can be able to create ourselves, our crops, and if we do not depend on others, in strategic times, it will be useful. See, earlier we used to depend on USA for our rice. But later on we became indigenous, we tried to use green revolution, etc. to increase our crop, and now we became self-sustained, that is we can sustain ourselves, and sometimes we are exporting also. So we have to go to that extent. But in some crops we are still import dependent, that is we depend on imports. So if we go for GM crops, our import dependency will reduce. The next is socio-economic benefits. See, this increases production. That is, if you use GM crops, the production will increase and will raise farmers' income. So there are socio-economic benefits in it. Indian farmers are still practicing old traditional process of seeding and cultivation. Though we will not expect them to go for GM crops directly, we can expect them to go for organic farming or use best practices to increase the crop yield. You can also observe another advantage that use of pesticide and insecticide during farming will be reduced. We are spending a lot of money on this both. If you are able to reduce these, then the farmer's income will raise substantially. We have seen food security, reduction in imports, socio-economic benefits, enhanced crop resilience, that is pest resistant, herbicide resistant. If the crops are able to become resistant to pests, our purpose is served. So enhanced crop resilience is important. Let's see the flip side of the coin, that is concerns of genetically modified crops. The resistance developed by pathogens, that is, see, you might have heard about antimicrobial resistance. That is, see, I am using a drug of 0.25 mg to cure fever. My fever is reduced. But the next time I will have to use 0.50 mg to reduce my fever. That is, my dosage has been increased. And in some cases, for example, I am using a X drug which is less powerful. I'll have to use Y and Z, which is extremely powerful to cure the disease. So the resistance developed by that pathogens will be increased, and for example, a pest called X will not die with the amount of pesticide I am using, and they develop resistance, and it will be an even further problem to tackle this pest. See, the next one is monopoly. That is, see, for example, you are using genetically modified crops only, then the natural flow of the crops will get disrupted. This production imposes high risks for disruption of our ecosystem and biodiversity, because the better traits which are produced from engineered genes can be favorable only to one organism. Hence, the gene flow is reduced. The next one is outcrossing. See, in BT cotton itself, if you see, we are using one bacterium for plant. Two different species altogether. So when you go for outcrossing, the problems will also increase, because they are not closely related. They are two different species. See, we have discussed about autologous and heterologous in previous videos. That is, autologous is, it is our own immune system. Heterologous is others. So if you use others organ for survival, you do not know what will be the survival rate. But if you use your own cells for curing a disease, the potentiality to reduce the disease is more. The next is decline in yield. That is, excessive production of genetically modified foods will render ineffective over time, because the pests that these toxins used to deter might eventually provide resistance. So as we have discussed earlier, after a time these pests may get resistance also. So in this way the yield might get reduced. Next is concerns for human health. That is the reason we have not allowed genetically modified crops without proper field trials into India. Only we are allowed 2002 BT cotton, which is not an edible one. So we really do not know what are the repercussions of genetically modified crops. So there is a concern for human health, and there is a concern for environment also. See, the ecological cycle gets disturbed. For example, an insect is eaten by a bird. A bird is eaten by an eagle. So this flow will get reduced, and the higher animals will suffer. So this is some of the repercussions of GM crops. There are regulatory challenges as well. First is possibility of data manipulation. That is, data is getting manipulated regarding genetically modified crops and concerns regarding genetically engineered appraisal council. We have seen it comes under Ministry of Environment. It is raising concerns about the genetically modified crops. We do not know what will be the repercussions on land, ecosystem, etc. So GEAC is raising concerns on it. And functioning of district level committees. See, we also have seen in the regulatory framework that state level committees and then district level committees. There is a stark difference between district level committee and state level committee and the central committees. So there is no coordination and coherence should be developed to overcome the regulatory challenges. See, in various parts of the world, we have tested different types of crops, and in United States, etc., genetically modified corn, soya, cotton, papaya, rice, rapeseed oil, potato, tomatoes, dairy products, and peas. In this, all genetically modified organisms were used. So, what we have to do way forward? First is create a policy on genetically modified crops. It is very much necessary. And then develop transparency. See, researchers and scientists have come out with results. See, these results should be in public so that the people fear can be reduced. And moreover, if it is potentially good, we can use it. And if there are some aftermath effects of that crop, we can eliminate in using them. So it should be a transparent process. Next is legal measures. That is, there should be legal measures provided by the government if some company tries to manipulate the protocol of the organization and try to introduce some crops which are illegal. The next is cooperation in the government and with the companies. See, district level committees should have coordination with state level committees, and they have to coordinate with center. In the same way, all of them should cooperate with the companies and other stakeholders like NGOs, farmers themselves should be incorporated in taking decisions. The next is patent regime. Patent is the exclusive right to create an entity. It might be some seeds or crops, etc. And the next is analyze cost benefit of the new technology. See, if genetically modified crops is introduced, what are the repercussions of it? See, cotton we have bought in. 90% of cotton now, which is produced, is from BT cotton. So it was a very well crafted decision. But if you take BT brinjal, we do not know what are the repercussions of it. So it is very difficult to anticipate what will happen. And next is tough regulation. There we have already seen that government is very tough about this decision, and it is not allowing BT or any other genetically modified crops. On this note, thank you. If you have any feedback, suggestions or comments, the comment box is open for you. Thanks again.